think we're at part 36. You know, now that I've had time to make sense of a lot of this stuff, I look at it differently, but I'm trying to bring myself back to the mindset. And at this point in time, I was really, really starting to get confused. I'm going to rewind back a second and just tell you guys something so that, you know, moving forward, things make sense. When we had that meeting with the palliative care team and they had suggested a lawyer to us, okay? You guys remember the meeting? I played you a little bit of it. They had suggested this lawyer who worked pro bono with cancer patients, and my mom told me to call a lawyer. So I gave the lawyer a call, and we made an appointment with him. He was supposed to come the previous week. I think it was the previous Friday. I had to call up and cancel out on him because my mom was being brought in for a procedure that day. Okay, so I called him back. I told my mom, we had discussed it. I called him back. My mom told him to come up to the hospital. So he was coming up that day, that same day that I sat down and the doctor told me that my mom was terminally ill. So it's like, I just walk out of this meeting, right, with the doctor. And now I have to go back into my mom's room knowing this horrible news, knowing that this doctor thinks that my mom should give up. My mind was all over the place. And I have to walk into this room and pretend I don't know this. It's so hard to explain. We had a discussion and I should probably elaborate on this a little bit more, but my mom was in such denial of what was going on. And it's not that the doctor was like 100% sure that, you know, my mom's dying like soon, but you know, it was just an option that he was trying to give to us. You know, ultimately the decision was going to be up to my mom. But we were kind of at the same time proceeding on to see if she could get into this rehab facility. So it was kind of like everything was left up in the air at that point. I'm walking back into the room. I knew my mom was in there with the physical therapist and the lawyer's on his way any minute. That morning, again, have to do a little rewind here. That morning, my mom texted my brother, meaning to text me. She had accidentally sent him a text asking him when this lawyer was coming. I think she told him that a lawyer was coming. I just think she didn't tell him when. She told me, she's like, oh my God, I text messaged your brother by accident. This was in the morning. This is before I even got to the hospital. So I was like, oh, all right. Well, you know, he's going to find out anyway. So it's probably better that you should tell him. At the same time, this was really weird, okay? I have to kind of explain my mind state at this point in time, all right? There's cameras being planted in my mom's house. That day I went in and my brother was taking care of the bills. Like, I started getting a little bit paranoid. Like, I was like, is my mom, like, in on this stuff with them? Like, what is going on? And I didn't want to harass my mom about the camera, but I did ask about it. And she couldn't give me an answer as to why this camera was being planted in the house. Like, she just didn't want to answer me. Looking back now, I realize why. I think she just didn't want to like add more fuel to the fire and make things worse between me and my brother. She tells me that morning that this lady, I think it was this palliative care lady, called her and told her that she should see the lawyer by herself. So I was like, okay, I'm not going to sit there and argue with her. So I was like, okay, if you want to see him by yourself, you know, I'll leave the room when he comes. Like, I had no problem with it. I wasn't going to argue with her. I get out of that meeting. I'm walking to my mom's room. I felt like it was like the walk of doom because I'm like, here it is now. I know this like information. And you know, I'm not going to tell her. And I feel so bad about it. So I walk into her room and, you know, she was doing good with the physical therapist. He actually got her to sit in the chair for like a good hour that day. That was good. So she's back in bed and the lawyer comes walking in just as the physical therapist is leaving. Okay. This guy must have just passed the bar exam. No wonder why he was pro bono. He's getting paid. He had a grant from the hospital, but it's like, dude, this guy was so young, okay? So I ask my mom, do you want me to get out of the room? And she looks at the attorney and he's kind of like, you know, my mom's like, well, what do you think? And he's like, at the end of the day, it's up to you. My mom's like, all right, whatever, just stay. So I was like, all right. So I'm sitting there. He's asking her all these like basic questions. What's your name, birthday, address? And then he gets into the whole part with the will and, you know, what do you want? And she's like, obviously my mom, you know, and dad always said that everything was going to be split 50-50. I just want to tell you guys this, okay? Because a lot of people don't know this. And part of me doing this is to kind of like help people understand how wills work and how estate settlement works, because there's no manual anywhere. It's very complicated. Saying that you're splitting everything 50-50 is such like a vague term. Money-wise, you know, that's all you need. 50-50, great. So any assets and anything like that, once it's all collected and the money's all put into an account, it's divided in half, okay? But then, like, you go through the house and there's other things, and that's where the fights usually occur, okay? Over the shit that doesn't have any value. I'm not going to get into that now. You guys are going to see that because I'm bringing you guys through the entire state settlement process. I mean, the entire thing. And I even started vlogging while I was doing it. So you guys are going to see a lot of videos of me while it was happening. Now, I had always been under the impression, I told you guys this, but I just want to remind you, that my brother was the executor on my mom's estate. For the last 3 years prior to this, my mom was telling me, Leanna, you know, I need to switch it to you. It was nothing personal against my brother. It was because of his wife. That was really the only reason. She thinks she's so smart. She has my whole family convinced that she's like this smart, business savvy woman. Good, that's great. Go be a business savvy woman with your family. This is my family. All of a sudden, I'm sitting there. I ask my mom who he wants to be the executor on her will. And my mom turns to him and she's like, well, I'd like both my son and my daughter to be co-executors. Like, I was just sitting there like, really? I didn't say anything. It's my mom's choice. If that's what she wanted, that's what she wanted. I just kind of made a face and I was just like, whatever. And then my mom turns to the attorney and she's like, oh, she thinks there's going to be fighting, but I don't think so. And in my heart of hearts, I really think my mom believed that because I think my mom was just in denial. I think she was in denial of her cancer. I think she was in denial of what my brother was doing and why he was doing it. And she was in denial just about the state of mine and my brother's relationship. I said, you know what, Mom? It's your choice. That's it. It is what it is. What am I supposed to do? I was really hurt. And at this point in time, I knew that my brother and his wife were manipulating my mom. And I'm going to tell you guys how I knew this. For the last 3 years of my life, since Satan's been in our lives, my mom's been saying the same thing. The same thing that she's like, I got to get, you know, your brother off the as executor and put you on. Even up until a week prior, my mom was saying that, right? You guys all heard her. I knew my mom had a conversation with my brother and Satan that Saturday. And the reason I really knew why was because that morning, my mom said something to me that really hurt me. She was like, you know, Leanna, I don't think you're going to be able to handle all this stuff. I was like, okay, like, since when did you not think that I was going to be able to handle it? She's like, you know, just selling the house and you've already done so much. Obviously, my husband would help me. I would have to hire a lawyer. Like, why all of a sudden are you doubting me? My mom never doubted me. Never doubted me, ever. And I'm not just, like, trying to say this to, like, inflate my ego or anything. My mom was so proud of me, and I know that, because she reminded me all the time. She would always tell me, Leanna, I don't know how you do this. You're so strong. You could do anything. My mom knew how I was, and that, like, if I don't know how to do something, I figure it out. I don't just sit around like a helpless, you know, victim all the time and be like, oh my God, I don't know how to do something. My mom knows that, like, if I want to learn how to do something, I will figure it out. And for her to all of a sudden be saying that now, I was like completely shocked. And I was hurt. I was hurt. I know it's not coming from you. I know that my brother and his wife were putting things in her head. And I found out. It was confirmed they were. I finally got a confirmation that they were. And I'll tell you guys how, but I'm not going to tell you yet. I went home that night. That day was just like draining, emotionally draining. I was really, really, really upset. I remember I called up my mom's cousin who lives down in Florida and she asked me, do you really think your mom's ready to give up right now? I went home and I was reading about dialysis. Like, it's just stopping dialysis. You're talking like 3 or 4 days and you're dead. You can't live that long without your kidneys. It sounded really scary to me. And I felt like, you know, my mom's not ready to give up. I'm not going to give up on her just yet. Maybe it was selfish of me. I don't know. At that point in time, I just wanted to get her out of the hospital and get her home. And even if that meant home with me, my husband and I were ready to give up half our house downstairs, our whole family rooms, and let her have her kind of own apartment down there so that he could take care of her, but she could have her privacy. Because, like, I was like, if she's gonna die anywhere, she's gonna die at home, surrounded by the people that she loves. That's how I felt at the time. I had proposed it to her, and she was completely on board with it. I gotta tell you guys, my brother did not come that week. I ended up finding out from my mom that my brother did not come to the hospital, like, that whole week. Because I know if they would have came up, they would have taken that camera. That Friday comes. It was the first time he had come back to the hospital. He asked my mom for the key back to go to the house so he could get the box for the camera. My mom told me this. She's like, oh, you know, Steven came and he took his camera. He needs the box for it. So he asked me for the key back to the house. And I'm like, oh, how convenient, you know? So I'm like, dude, I am definitely going to hear something about this camera. You know what this motherfucker tells her? He was like all pissed off and telling my mom that I owe him $200 for the camera. My mom, being how she is, my mom's like, I'll pay for it. I'll give you the $200. So she told me about it. And I'm like, mom. First of all right, I told you guys this in the last video. I made a very conscious decision not to talk about the camera, like, and anything with my brother. And I got out of that meeting on that Thursday. I was like, all right, I'm not talking about my brother anymore and all this bullshit. So I was like quiet that whole week about him. I didn't ask any questions about him or nothing. You're such a bitch. Your mom's in the hospital. I don't fucking care if you know, if you knew that she was terminal, whatever. Why are you whining to your mother like a little fucking baby? So I told my mom, I was like, mom, I'm not talking about this. I don't want to talk about cameras. I don't want to talk about this. This shit doesn't belong in the room right now. In my head, this is like not an emergency right now. You're driving a Mercedes. You have a housekeeper. You have a fucking nanny. Are you that hard up for $200 right now? Is this important right now on a Friday that you're sitting here worrying about this fucking camera? Once again, you're going to my mom's house to get a box for this camera that you're claiming is damaged that you can't sell. So he told my mom that he can't sell it. So he wants you to pay him $200 so he could get a new one. But I'm thinking, didn't he say he gave it to you? Like, I don't understand how this works. Let me just lay this out for you guys, okay? Satan claims she won this camera in a contest. So she didn't pay for this camera. She got it for free. And she didn't want it. So she decided she was going to give it to my mom. Means that it's no longer yours. She didn't say borrow. She said give. She decided that she was going to give it to my mom. Mom was going to accept it. The ownership has been transferred over to my mom. Once it was in my mom's house, technically, you shouldn't care about it anymore because it's not yours. How does he know my mom didn't tell me to take it away or give it to somebody else or whatever? Now all of a sudden, you want money for this thing that you won that was so valuable to you, you gave it away to somebody else. Just because I had it in my possession, now you wanted $200 for it. Am I alone on this? Does anybody else see how fucked up this is? So I'm like, mom, don't even worry about it. I don't even want to talk about this camera anymore. It's so ridiculous. Of course, I call my husband up. I'm like, shit, you douchebag, sucker, Satan, this one. Like, you know, of course. Again, I was really trying to keep this drama out of my mom's room at this point. The camera is so fucking irrelevant to what's going on right now. Our mom's like dying. They're talking about putting her in hospice and a fucking camera is just not important right now. You are not hard up for $200 when you're driving a Mercedes. In the meantime, I finally got my mom to get on that antidepressant, okay? They put her on this Cymbalta. The doctors told me that it would take a little bit to get her adjusted and start feeling the effects. Now the weekend comes, okay? Saturday. It was quiet. You know, I just gotta mention this. Nobody from my mom's family, like, ever came up on the weekends. It was so weird. They would always wait for, like, a Monday or a Tuesday night to come up. I was like, I don't understand, like, why you wouldn't come and sit here with her for a couple of hours. And, you know, at this point in time, I'm not really communicating with anybody. So I have no idea what my brother and his wife were telling them. My mom would ask me every single day when I came into the hospital, did anybody from my family call you? And I'd be like, no, ma, just my cousin Nico and Aunt Dana. And finally, it got to a point where, like, I went in there one day and my mom was just like, my family sucks. And I was like, you know, I couldn't even argue with her because I was like, why aren't these people here on weekend? I don't understand. So that Saturday, I remember, she seemed a little bit better, even though she was still kind of out of it and apathetic. And I felt really bad for her because, like, she couldn't get out of bed to, like, bathe herself, you know? She couldn't take a shower. So her hair wasn't, like, super greasy or anything because she's not moving around. But, like, my mom was on prednisone, which, like, makes your hair grow, like, crazy. My mom's hair was, like, so thick, dude. It was, like, crazy. She had so much hair. Along with that, unfortunately, comes other, you know, problems. You grow facial hair and stuff like that. At Saturday night, I was like, you know, I want to do something special for her. So I brought up wax and I waxed her eyebrows and her mustache. And I, you know, we kind of fixed her hair. I had bought this like shampoo stuff and we brushed it and everything. And we kind of like freshened her up, you know, I washed her up and everything. I felt so bad because like she just wanted to take a shower, you know, but she couldn't. So it was nice. That was probably like one of the like, I don't know, last nights that we had like that cool, just me and her hanging out, bonding, doing girl things. Me and my mom used to do this shit all the time. Like, you know, I would go over her house. I dyed her hair for her. I would wax her eyebrows. She went to my brother's wedding. I did her makeup for her. Like we did this kind of shit, you know? So it was kind of cool getting, you know, being able to... All right, get it together, Leanna. Sorry. It was kind of cool being able to do that stuff again with her. Like, just those, like, mom-daughter bonding things, you know? I miss doing those things so much. Like, we used to, like, share nail polish and... you know, me and my mom, we were never able to, like, share clothes or shoes or anything. So, like, we shared jewelry and, like, that kind of stuff. Like, we would trade nail polishes and makeup and stuff like that. Like, I just wanted to do something that was going to make her feel better about herself that night, you know? Because she can't get up and wash her hair and do these things. Really, like, that was, like, and, you know, looking back now, that was, like, one of the last nights I had like that with her. And it was really, like, those moments are the ones that I'm so thankful for because I spent every second with her that I could. I just couldn't let go of her. And, you know, I want to tell you guys a kind of weird story. My mom like always used to tell me that like I was such a mama's girl. I wouldn't go to anybody else, you know, when I was a baby. I just clung to my mom so tight. And it's kind of like symbolic of how I am even as an adult. I just held on to her so tight. Like I just couldn't let go of her. She like literally was my best friend. Like, you know, friends come and go through life, but my mom was always there for me, no matter what, no matter what. She would get mad at me sometimes, and I would get mad at her, but, like, we always came back together. There was such a bond there. I don't have that type of bond with anybody in my life like that, like, the bond I had with her. And I just miss that. I miss hanging out with her. And my mom told me that when I was a baby, her sisters always used to want to hold me. And one time, I don't know, her and my Aunt Debbie, they, you know, traded shirts, trying to trick me because my Aunt Debbie just wanted to hold me as a baby. It's kind of like funny. It's this whole story, like with now and how things turned out in my life, how I am. It's kind of weird. It's kind of like you're always, like, you're born who you are. My Aunt Debbie traded shirts with my mom and was trying to, you know, trick me into thinking that she was my mom. And my mom told me that I kept pulling her face and I knew it wasn't my mom. Even as an infant, I was able to tell it wasn't my mom. And as soon as I realized it wasn't her, I just started hysterically crying and my mom had to take me back because I just wouldn't go to anybody else, you know? You can't recreate that bond, you know? So it kind of just goes to show two things. One, that my mom and I were just so connected. And the other is just that, like, you can't trick me. You can't trick me. My mom always told me, even when my 30th birthday rolled around, my mom was like, I can't throw a surprise party because you're gonna know. Like, she just knew how I was. You know what? I'm gonna end this one and come back in the next.